As it says in the introduction, I'm James Boustead. I'm a managing director at Morgan Stanley, which, if you've not heard of them, they're quite a large global financial services firm. And I run a technology organization called Legal Compliance and Governance Technology. And one of the responsibilities for my organization is to support Morgan Stanley's anti-corruption, bribery, and global financial crime organization. And that's quite a big deal, not just for Morgan Stanley, but for our regulators. And there are certain things that, as a large, globally significant financial institution, that we are regulatory mandated to have in place. And one of those things is what we call our single client view. We have to have a view across the entire enterprise of Morgan Stanley, all our businesses in all the countries all around the world, of a customer. And what do we know about that customer? Now, my personal relationship and Morgan Stanley's relationship with Palantir dates back to around 2013. And we had Gotham as our tool of choice for managing our single client view. Now, Gotham is a great tool, but I think it's fair to say when we started looking at Foundry, we were on a relatively, our Gotham implementation was a little, wasn't as up to date as it could have been, so we had some decisions to make. Do we look to upgrade Gotham, or do we look at Foundry? And one of the things we did was we put Foundry through a very intense evaluation. We had architects look at it and make a decision, and that this is our sort of why Foundry. There's lots of reasons why Foundry is a great tool, but there's plenty of people from Palantir here who can sell Foundry that you don't need me to do that. But there were really three things for us that made Foundry our tool of choice to be our new single client view solution. One was the data management capabilities. Financial crime is a data intensive problem. Having a single view of a client across an enterprise as large as Morgan Stanley, hundreds of countries, 80,000 people, millions of accounts, is a data problem. Modern technology stack. One of the things that we liked about Foundry was we could incorporate it into the Morgan Stanley ecosystem. It's an API-driven platform. It's not a full-stack solution where I have to use the back-end, the front-end, the UI. I can build my own UIs against the Palantir API, and I can make it look to my client base or my user base as if they're in a Morgan Stanley system, even though it's powered by Foundry in the background. And then the final thing from our perspective is there's this really cool tool that comes as part of Foundry, and it's called Slate. And what Slate allowed us to do was very rapidly, we could test the Foundry APIs, we could test the search capabilities, even though we hadn't actually built the Morgan Stanley UI yet that would sit on top of those APIs. So it was a real accelerator from our perspective. So this is our why Foundry. Now, multiple times you've heard people say this morning that no plan survives first contact. And this is where I'm going to start our Foundry journey with our plan not surviving first contact. So June the 30th, 2021, a date that's etched in my memory, this was going to be our Foundry go live date. This is what we were committed to. We have great partnerships with Palantir. Everyone was very excited about it. We had an aging Gotham implementation that we wanted to take out of production. Palantir wanted us to take it out of production. We wanted to take it out of production. We were going to go live with Foundry June the 30th, according to our plan. Now, Foundry is very much designed around cloud deployments. There are lots of great capability in Foundry that lend itself really well to cloud deployments, but does present places like Morgan Stanley with some challenges when it comes to an on-prem deployment, which is what we were going with. So we had some software development lifecycle changes that were challenging for us, which introduced some delay into our plan. So we weren't going to make June the 30th. So our Gotham implementation is a little stale. Palantir are concerned with the fact it's on old hardware. We're concerned with the fact it's on old hardware with old operating systems that we collectively feel is a potential security threat that obviously we don't want to be exposed to. this is an application that the regulators tell us we have to have up, so we can't just turn it off. But we're going to be 2 months late on our Foundry deliverable. So this is the start of our perfect storm. What we agree with our partners in Palantir is we're not going to do anything to our production environment where Gotham is running. We're not going to reboot servers. We're not going to change the environment in any way. We're going to lock it down for 2 months, and we're all going to get our heads down, and we're going to get Foundry live. That was the next bit of the plan that didn't survive first contact. So we get to August the 31st, and Morgan Stanley's security architecture turns around and says, bit of a problem with Foundry, which was perfect timing for them as we were about to go live. And that problem was Foundry communicates with something called the Apollo service. And what it does is it sends telemetry out to the Apollo service, and then the Apollo service can determine what it can do to that Foundry implementation to make it more efficient. It can deploy patches, it can deploy configuration changes, but these are deployed into the production environment. And Morgan Stanley's security architecture had some concerns with that. So what do we do? We're now stuck. So the concern was around something coming into the production environment that could have a destabilizing effect on the Morgan Stanley production environment, a very real concern. So we agreed, and these things sound easy to say, there was hours and hours behind this, but we actually agreed a risk acceptance where we could put Foundry into production in a production parallel mode with a small group of users, just so it's running in parallel with Gotham, so we can test that everything works and make sure that once we can get around this security concern, we can go live. September the 18th, the next thing that we hadn't anticipated hits our plan. So I know the comments around plans not surviving first contact. I think Mike Tyson said everyone has a plan until they get punched in the face. September the 18th was when I got punched in the face, metaphorically speaking. We'd agreed with Palantir that we weren't going to do anything to our Gotham environment because of the risks around it. Due to another regulatory initiative that Morgan Stanley had to comply with, we had to upgrade the hardware that our Gotham system was running on. So now we've got a problem. We can't do anything to this environment. We can't take down the application because the regulators say we have to have it up. And we can't continue to run on the infrastructure the way it is because the regulators won't allow us to do that. So this is where the perfect storm is starting to play out. So what do we do? And every single thing that happened along this timeline, by the way, is about security, whether it's from Palantir's side or Morgan Stanley's side. It's all about how we make sure this is secure. But at the same time, the thing that got us through this was the partnership. Every one of these events that I'm talking about, as I'm sure you can imagine, were generating lots of stress, it's fair to say. And in times of stress, as the title will say, that's when it tests the partnership. And at every step on this journey, we had to make compromises. Morgan Stanley had to make compromises. Palantir had to make compromises. Morgan Stanley Security don't make compromises. Sorry, one firm. Which really focused us on how to do this right. September the 21st was a breakthrough date for us. We got a risk acceptance from Morgan Stanley's security architecture, the Cyber Infrastructure and Governance Committee, told us that we could go live in production with Foundry. Woohoo! If, and only if, the Apollo service was disabled. So it wasn't ideal. What this meant was we were effectively going to go in with a version of the software that was going to be static. We couldn't get patches, we couldn't get updates, we couldn't get efficiency configuration changes. We would have to monitor it manually because we weren't sending the telemetry back to Apollo for the automated monitoring. but we could go live. And they would give us a risk acceptance for 12 months to figure this out. So this was the first, maybe the first night I slept in the month of September 2021. So this was a big deal for us. And we went live across our entire client base on October the 4th, 2021. The key thing that this enabled us to do was to decommission our Gotham infrastructure before October the 31st, which was the date that we would have had to update the infrastructure that it was running on in order to meet the other regulatory obligation. So from our perspective, we're out of the woods. We've got this thing live, Foundry's there, all our users are on it, we've got our single client view application, the regulators are happy, we don't have an infrastructure over here that doesn't have encrypted disks on it. That's all being decommissioned by the end of October. So those regulators are happy. And then what happens? Next punch in the face. It's called Log4j. Log4j happened in, I think, the zero-day vulnerability was December the 13th, 2021. Okay. The version of Foundry that we were live with in production had the library version 2.14, which had the vulnerability in it. Okay, so patch it. I can't patch it, because I've got the Apollo service disabled. Turn on the Apollo, take the patch. I can't do that, because I get fired. Which was a big deal for me, personally. So we find ourselves presented with another perfect storm. Again, this is where partnership came into it. And we worked closely with Palantir, and we managed a temporary fix. The vulnerable code was still in the production implementation. But what Palantir did is they changed startup parameters around Foundry so it bypassed those libraries. So from Morgan Stanley's perspective, we had a solution in place that was acceptable to Morgan Stanley security. We still had the vulnerable libraries in our production environment, but we could demonstrate that they were not being invoked. Oops. Because of our partnership with Palantir. So that took us through 2021. February the 25th of this year, Morgan Stanley Engineering and Palantir Engineering had come up with a solution which we felt would get Morgan Stanley Security, the Cyber Infrastructure Governance Committee, this infamous body, happy with a proposal that would allow us to change our deployment and turn on the Apollo service in production. Morgan Stanley's CISO, Chief Information Security Officer, I learned all these acronyms during this journey, he personally signed off on this architecture approach. And this was something that we came up with collectively. So that period of time between December 2021 and February 2022, we weren't all off enjoying our year-end holiday. Our engineers and Palantir's engineers were working feverishly on what we can do that's gonna get this governing body happy. What we decided was the right implementation was we were going to put Palantir into a separate networked environment within the Morgan Stanley environment so that we could enable internet access out, but it could only connect to the Apollo server. And if anything bad were to come down from the Apollo server, it would be restricted within that network environment and couldn't affect the broader Morgan Stanley production environment. Everyone was happy with that, which was wonderful. And on August the 22nd, we went live with a fully built out new, because we had to go and get a whole load of infrastructure, we had to build a whole new network domain. We couldn't turn off our existing production implementation, so we had to build this plane while the other plane was still flying. We built out the network space, we built out the new Foundry implementation, we turned on the Apollo service. We got all the nice updates that came through, the patches, the Log4j libraries disappeared out of the production environment, and on August the 22nd, we went live. So what now? Finally, we could collectively turn our energies to some of the benefits of being on Foundry after this year journey, and we are now working with our partners in Palantir to look at other capabilities in the financial crime space that we can leverage the platform on that data for. This is the type of conversation we wanted to be able to have 12 months earlier. But as I say, security meant that we had to rely on our excellent partnership to navigate us through a perfect storm. And that's time. Thank you very much.